We'll get started in a couple of minutes. Okay, the Committee on Accountability and Administrative Review is now in session. Today's hearing is on the Department of Managed Healthcare and Department of Insurance rescission settlement agreements. I want to start by quoting a couple of things or focusing on a couple of things at each of these departments. First of all, I'll quote from Secretary Bonner's testimony before Congress in July of 2008, where he said that rescission, this is the retroactive cancellation of health insurance policies, renders a person both uninsured and often in the middle of care, as well as uninsurable in the future. This is why this practice is so pernicious. And I think his testimony before Congress was right on in terms of identifying why it's so serious, why this is such an important issue. Both Department of Insurance and Department of Managed Health Care announced settlements to go back and clean up some wrongful practices by different insurance companies and HMOs. He also, Mr. Bonner, Secretary Bonner, at that hearing, said that one of the things that is most troubling is that these actions are usually taken because enrollees are using health services. In other words, because they're sick. So this is why the actions were taken. This is such a serious issue. They announced with a great fanfare in both cases these settlements. This is, again, from Secretary Bonner's testimony. He said that with these actions, the department has achieved what it set out to do: change the national landscape to stop the unfair and illegal practice of rescission by holding plans accountable, made sure that health plans are fair and consumers understand what is being asked of them on health history applications, jumped in to restore coverage as broadly as possible for patients unfairly rescinded in the middle of care, avoided lengthy court battles for individuals seeking monetary reimbursement from the plans, and restored confidence in the individual market. These are his statements in terms of what he accomplished. By contrast, you have the statement to the court by the Los Angeles City Attorney. It was an amicus curiae brief in the case of Anthem Blue Cross v. Superior Court of the State of California. This is regarding whether a city could engage in litigation with regard to regulatory issues like the rescission settlements that took place. And in that brief, the L.A. city attorney says, because the People's Action seeks relief that goes further than what the DMHC settled for with Blue Cross, the People's Action could demonstrate that the DMHC fell short of its administrative duties. Thus, the DMHC finds itself in the awkward position of contending that greater relief for patients for Blue Cross's wrongful rescissions would somehow be harmful to patients in the long run. I thought that was very well stated in terms of the settlements, the performance of the settlements, the follow-through with those settlements, and going forward, the benefit to the consumers, which after all is what Department of Insurance and Department of Managed Healthcare are supposed to be doing. In terms of the Department of Insurance, just comparing the press release from December of 07, where the insurance commissioner said he was seeking $12.6 million in fines for Blue Shield for violations regarding rescissions. In December of 08, 1 year later, the Department of Insurance, the insurance commissioner, settled with Blue Shield with no fine. So press release, $12 million. Result, no fine. February of 09, Insurance Commissioner Poizner announces a settlement with Blue Cross, says $14 million in reimbursements are available for 2,300 rescinded enrollees. At present, 78 rescinded enrollees have collected a whopping $798,000. Again, in relation to his press release with the $14 million. So that is why we are here. We're here because in a regulatory agency, when they say they're going to do something, we all have the expectation that they're going to follow through. We are here to talk about what happened between the press releases and the real day-to-day functioning of these departments with regard to these rescissions. With that, our first witness is Brian Lang. He is Executive Director of the Institute of Health Law Studies at the at California Western School of Law and has been following rescission issues for quite a while. Mr. Lang.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Question of the chair. Traditionally, we've had a member from the auditor's office and the legislative analyst's office. Why are we doing why is the process different today, Mr. Chair?
Because the analysis that is in here, it came from the investigations of this committee staff. There is no internal expert within the LAO or these other agencies. So Mr. Lang has been monitoring these issues for years. It's just like in the hearing that we had with regard to stimulus funds. On that occasion, we brought in an expert from, I think he was from UC San Diego, who was an expert analyst on the outside who came in to edify us on how you could track some of these dollars. So that's, I think, the analogy is Mr. Lang is an outside expert in rescission issues. Thank you for asking the question.
Okay, thank you very much. Good morning to you all. Chairman De La Torre, Vice Chair Strickland, distinguished members of the Accountability and Administrative Review Committee. My name is Brian Liang, and as the chair indicated, I am the executive director of the Institute of Health Law Studies at California Western School of Law. I am also the co-director of the San Diego Center for Patient Safety at UCSD School of Medicine. I'm also a professor of anesthesiology there, although I actually do use anesthesia to put people to sleep rather than just talking at them. What I want to do is today, as the chair indicated, I would like to speak to you about the CDI and DMHC rescission settlements. First, I want to make sure that I would like to recommend the briefing materials that were provided by the staff of the committee. They really are awesome, very well written, very well and complete. I really do recommend those. As well, I've also provided my own textual materials for you. I have a PowerPoint that I'm going to go through quickly, but the textual materials will have everything that I'm going to say orally here today. With respect to this testimony, here's the roadmap. I'm going to give a bottom line.
It's tab 7 in your binders.
Yeah, I'd love to have one of those binders at some point. I'm going to go through the bottom line first of my analysis and then move right into a description of what rescission is, just very briefly, some key components of the settlements, the results associated with the settlements, and then my analysis of the settlement agreements and their success. Okay, first, the bottom line. Unfortunately, the rescission settlements with these illegally acting insurers had very limited success when we measure it by victim participation. On a root cause analysis, the settlements didn't take into account victim perspectives and what they perceived were necessary for their own needs. Very complex and legalistic, communicated poorly. There was no feedback system in place. Relied on unfamiliar and very complicated dispute resolution systems favoring the insurers, and lacked standardization due to negotiations rather than simple mandates on insurers. So apparently at this point, many people start to fall asleep. Okay, just as a rescission overview, just briefly, the background rule is healthcare insurers have to make a good faith effort to resolve all reasonable questions regarding an applicant's info before granting coverage. They've got to do it beforehand. Rescission is pulling back by the health insurer of that coverage when it was initially accepted. Now, importantly, rescission is limited to the individual healthcare market because it is subject to underwriting. Group health insurance plans are not. Now, rescission is allowed. Basically, if the insurer can show that the applicant lied about their healthcare status, then of course they can rescind. And I'm an old contracts professor, you know, there is no agreement if somebody's lying about what the consideration is. Now, that's a very limited circumstance. Rescission is absolutely prohibited if it's based on post-claims underwriting, revoking coverage when high-cost claims are received or potentially high-cost diseases are diagnosed, and they usually seize on any inconsistency they can find, these insurers, on the application. Or they look at an innocent mistake and say, you lied, so we're going to pull away this coverage from you. Now, what's important to realize is that this is an incredibly important policy issue because it has real effect on people. It leaves these patients as if they had never had any coverage in the first place. It saddles them with past and present health care bills, and now they can't get coverage because now they have a pre-existing condition and no insurer is ever going to come back and come through and give them coverage. And as the chair indicated, this often happens right at the outset or during serious illness treatment. One phenomenal, incredible example was late-stage breast cancer. You pull this person's coverage while she's in stage 4 breast cancer. She only has a 1 in 50 shot anyway. Now she has a 0 in 50 shot. So very important. This has real effect on real people. Now, after tremendous numbers of patient complaints and DMHC and CDI investigations, legislative attention, including by the chair of this committee, media reports primarily in the LA Times and the Daily Journal, and private litigation, illegal post-claims underwriting rescission practices were found widespread amongst the major insurers in this state. So this led appropriately to DMAT and CDI negotiating settlements with these insurers to vindicate these victims, help them get back on their feet, get coverage, give them the money that should have been paid by the insurers, and then hopefully make things clearer in the future with respect to these particular practices. Now let's move over to a description of some of the key components of these settlement agreements. DMHC and CDI entered into separate agreements. Obviously, they have different purviews, so each of them entered into the agreements with their respective parties. The term of the agreements were 2004 to 2008. Within these agreements, there was no admission of wrongful conduct. And with respect to these agreements, although there were some differences, three themes really were similar across these agreements. First, they communicated the information about the settlement using letters. They were the victims were entitled to re-enrollment into some of these insurance companies, and there was an expedited review process to recover out-of-pocket payments that should have been paid for by these illegally acting insurers. Now, just describing these, the letters to the former enrollees, CDI required the insurers to send the victims letters itself, the insurers to send those victims itself, letters itself. DMHC generated its own letters. Descriptively, the CDI mandated letters range from about 7 to 11 pages long, and they detailed a lot of complicated information describing the settlements, the conditional terms, for example, option 1 versus option 2 and 3, option A versus option B, what you have to do to get access to it, and requirements for additional requests for more information to execute their rights. DMHC, by the way, both of these letters that I'm referring to here are in Appendix A and B of my testimony. Roughly 17 pages long for Blue Shield's letter, similarly complex as CDI's, insurer forms that have to be returned, all these other stuff that were included in these forms. Importantly, both CDI and DMHC letters did refer both referred the victims to original legal documents for additional information, as well as provided a toll-free number. These legal documents were lawyer drafted, both by DMHC and CDI. Letters and information are apparently only available in English, at least as a default. With materials that were provided to me and the staff, we were told later that there were available letters in different languages, but they were sent out in English, and the individuals were somehow provided information that they could call a phone number if they wanted the materials in a separate language. I could not find that in any of the letters or agreements, CDI letter or the DMHC letter that I was provided. The re-enrollment option allowed in the settlements allowed for former enrollees and insureds to reinstate their coverage, but only with the illegally acting insurer, not with anybody else, generally within 90 days. Victims had to fulfill the victim requirements, obviously, engage in another application using the insurance company forms, and agree to be subject to, quote unquote, today's premiums, no discounts, no upper limits in those premiums, and in some cases, payments for the first month had to accompany the application to kick in. Those who didn't receive the letters were allowed additional time to enroll, generally about 6 months. With respect to the expedited review process, CDI and DMHC did negotiate these expedited review processes with the insurers for victims to recoup their expenditures. Generally, it relied upon direct negotiation. Generally, the rescission victims had to negotiate with the insurer for any recovery. Again, this had to this relied on significant amount of documentation of various things, including medical necessity, the cost, coverage, service variables, as well as in some cases they had to fill out additional insurer forms. Generally within 90 days. Now, insurers could just simply reject the victim's claims, and this happened generally within 60 days, roughly. If the victims wanted to challenge that rejection, they had to enter into a JAMS overseen arbitration process, which also required detailed documentation. Using this process extinguished all the rights of the former enrollee insurers to any other legal recourse. So you enter into the system, you try to get money, you get whatever you get, that extinguishes your rights to be in a class action or any other kind of legal action. Now let's talk about the implementation. What were the results of the implementation? DMHC sent out about 3,400 letters about 2.5 months after the settlements. Unfortunately, about 1 out of 5 didn't receive these letters. Why this is important is that let's say if you talk about 1 out of 5, that's roughly about 540 people. If you assume $10,000 worth of damages per person, immediately what that means is $5 million is taken right off the table that the insurers have to pay. So they are.
Can I ask a question? How do we know that 500 people didn't get them?
This is the data that was provided to us from DMHC.
So DMHC did a survey then of all the people that should have received the letters, the 3,400 that went out, and then of those people that they polled each of them and asked whether or not they got the letter, and then 500 people said, no, we did not get the letter.
No, 2,700 people confirmed that they actually received the letter. And then they went through an additional process to try to find the people, and they couldn't find them.
So we don't necessarily have confirmation that they didn't receive the letter. We just have confirmation we couldn't, the state couldn't find them.
They had to sign to get the letter.
You have to. There was a verification process through which they determined whether they actually received it or not. And if DMHC didn't get a confirmation, then that was the presumption that they didn't receive it.
Okay.
Now, with respect to the substantive aspects, only about 5% accepted new coverage. 9% expressed interest in the recovery using the expedited review process. But according to data that we got yesterday, only about 92 people, about 2.7, actually used it. And we are also told yesterday that about 870,000 was recouped. I'm just using a 10,000 number based on that number, if you just assume 10,000 a person. Now, CDI mandated insurers to send out about 2,600 letters. Letters were sent out a little bit late, about 10 months after the settlement, settlements a little even later for HealthNet. About 1 out of 6 didn't receive these letters. And again, if you just do the math, that's about 330 people, average 10,000 apiece. That's another 3.3 million that gets taken off the table. For Blue Cross, this is the only data we have available in full. Only about 4% accepted new coverage. With respect to the expedited review process, only about 3% entered into the system, and these people got about $798,000. Again, that's about $10,000 a person. And if you compare that with the $14 million that the chair indicated was available, that means that only about 6% was recouped.
I'm sorry if I could interrupt one more time. You said also that all of the health plans also sent out letters in addition to CDI and
DMHC? Oh, no, I'm sorry.
DMHC?
I was unclear. DMHC generated its own letters, and they said, we'll send them out. CDI.
I thought you, a couple of slides back, I thought you also said that there was a 23-page letter and a 17-page letter and 13-page letter from each of these different health plans that also sent out information to...
No. CDI mandated letters 7 to 11 pages long. DMHC letters 17 pages long. So CDI mandated the insurers send out their own letter. DMHC said, we'll generate the letter. So it's a different philosophy.
Okay. Just trying to get a grasp on all this. Thank you.
Sure. Now we compare this with private litigation. This was the LA City Attorney and Bill Chernoff's litigation. About $6 million was available in the HealthNet settlement and $5.5 was paid. We don't know. Again, we don't have complete information from CDI yet about all of the settlements. We got additional information that about 10 more people, about 0.4%, accepted new coverage. With respect to the corrective action plans, as of today, at least on the website, there's no insurer corrective action plans that have been finalized. We were told on Monday by DMHC that things were not finalized or just certain portions were, and then yesterday we were told by DMHC that they were all finalized. But again, I don't have access to that information yet with respect to the final plans, so I'm sorry I missed that. I assumed at this point that they were in negotiation, at least on Monday. As of Monday, they were in negotiation, at least from the information I was provided. But even regardless of that, looking at the plans in draft form, there are a lot of variations. So for example, DMHC settlements, there wasn't a requirement to have third-party independent review. But Anthem and HealthNet committed to doing that. CDI required everybody to include third-party independent review. So this is just a flag to indicate there may be some conflict when we try to actually get harmonized how we're going to regulate these insurers. Compare this again with private litigation. The mandate for independent third-party review was a condition for settlement. And indeed, the condition also indicated that you couldn't withdraw or rescind until that third-party review was put into place. Analysis. Now, I really want to emphasize here, and I also want to emphasize to the people who are in DMHC and CDI in this room, I am not impugning your reputations, your good faith. I am certainly indicating to this committee I am not impugning or trying to tear down individuals, or I am not questioning at all the good faith of the people who tried to work on this area. It is a very difficult area to work on. You've got an 800-pound gorilla, probably the most powerful industry in the United States, that you have to work against. You have limited resources. I understand that completely. Having worked for the Federal Trade Commission myself, I understand the challenges. But this effort, and what I'm going to be discussing, is trying to help in identifying system weaknesses that hopefully we can learn from to do a better job in the future. That being said, unfortunately, virtually no victim took advantage of these settlement agreements, and therefore it really did do not a lot to bring justice to these victims and represented limited deterrence. Let's look at each of the reasons why. Limited outreach to victims. DMHC and CDI had limited communications with these victims and therefore didn't really have an opportunity for settlement preference assessments. They were very complex and legalistic, required a lot of victim actions, these documentations, drawn out, unfamiliar process. Compare this with class action litigation. You opt in or you opt out. And compare this also with the fact that if you're talking about an illegally acting insurer versus an innocent victim, you're putting the burden on the victim to go through this process and document everything. Really a challenge for that victim. DMHC and CDA may have better reached their goals if, for example, they set a level of success, 90% participation, let's say, and they sought the victim's point of view. So, for example, equal lump sum payments that are adjusted for adequate individual claimants, probably more suited to these populations. That's what was adopted in the private litigation in the LA City Attorney's Office. And this is not simply that. It's also other systems of class actions trying to get at getting these people, getting these victims what they need and some justice. Very complicated letters to the victims. Unfortunately, the settlement terms were kind of hoist by its own petard. They had to describe the very complicated settlement that the CDI and DMHC actually negotiated. Unfortunately, that created a heck of a lot of complexity. DMHC and CDI didn't consider standard health literacy or cultural competency issues or limited English proficiency and other language barriers. This is, in fact, something that has already been addressed by the legislature itself. They've actually mandated a lot of improved communication methodologies because of this. Indeed, I'm saying myself as a physician, we're now subject to medical communication mandates, and our goal is to aim for a third grade reading level. Unfortunately, despite the fact that California is the most culturally diverse state in the nation, and we celebrate that, that also means that about 40% of us don't speak English, and the settlement notices were drafted using college level prose with complex jargon, legal, insurance, and medical jargon, using only English. So it's very difficult to expect that a victim who is in this situation would be able to understand it. So DMHC and CDI might have wanted to consider more simple settlement terms, more victim-centered, and make these insurers underwrite the communications, because people do this for a living.
Also a question.
Hi.
You're telling me that 40%, 4 out of 10 residents of California don't speak English enough at a third grade level?
No, 40% of people, according to the census, don't speak English at home at all.
At home?
At home.
So some of those people do speak it outside the
home. Yeah. Okay, but that says it's just a pressure.
Well, I can tell you, having worked with many of these groups and working in the advisory committee, Minority Health, I should have clarified that it is at home, at home.
I do. It's just a presupposing here, the use of the term victim. I'm curious, when someone moves from being a patient or a customer to being a victim, what's the threshold that moves you from being a patient or a customer to victim? What determines you are now a victim?
Are you asking personally, or are you?
Well, you're making a presentation that these people are all victims, and I'm just curious at what point
there was
cross
a
threshold.
There is a factual occurrence. There were settlements with all of the major insurance companies that they were wrongfully rescinded.
So all
that
these
makes
are about
them. We're talking about that universe. That's it.
Specifically, those who were wrong.
That's all we're talking about. Is
okay.
the 5,000-6,000
people? Yeah. Or that we got conclusions about.
Very good.
That's all you're addressing in the PowerPoint. Yes.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Very good. Thank you.
It's orthopedic problem. I'm going to turn all the way around. So,
you're good work comp, Dylan.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Unless you're rescinded.
Yeah. Unless I'm rescinded.
They saw you turn the bus.
Now, of course, when we create new systems, you can't take everything into account. So what one has to do when one does create new systems is take into account the fact that you can't take everything into account. And that means we need a feedback system, keep your finger on the pulse, to determine how successful or how unsuccessful you're being with respect to what you're trying to do. So unfortunately, the settlements didn't provide for any feedback system to determine if the settlements were actually achieving the goals it wanted to. So, for example, if there had been monthly assessments performed to identify problems such as these very low victim participation rates, the agencies may have been able to identify what was failing early on. You know, when you're talking about 6,000 people, 500 per month, let's say, that you're trying to get into the system, yet, if, let's say, the first month you're only getting one or two or three, the next month one or two or three, that really helps you to understand, okay, maybe we should be focusing on this. So, for example, these tiny re-enrollment rates, we could have investigated why. Was it the fact that they didn't want to enroll in the plan that harmed them? And that's been reported in the media. There has been reports about that. Was it the higher premiums? Who knows what else? Low rates of expedited resolution review. Was it the fact that they were distrustful of the process? This is, in fact, again, this has been reported in the arbitration literature. They felt it was biased. It was too hard to get all that documentation in place. We could have investigated that. So if CDI and DMHC had engaged a feedback system, it would have allowed us to identify and dynamically evaluated the settlement to perhaps change course to promote better settlement participation to reach the goals. In addition, very unfamiliar complex system. Settlements relied on very legalistic process that really focused on the victim having the burden of proof, despite the fact that they were innocent in the process and didn't have the insurers come through, even though the insurers came to the table with dirty hands. Further, there was a legitimacy issue. No expedited dispute resolution process involved any patients or victim arbitrators or decision makers. And further, we really have to take into account these are not upper middle class healthy people. These are patients. They're suffering from or in treatment for just out of treatment with serious disease. So very difficult to have them come up with supporting documentation that often spanned years to prove their case and to impose insurer satisfaction. They're probably not going to have the energy. Anybody who's ever known anybody who's gone through cancer treatment knows, very tired, very difficult from the focus. And similarly, very unlikely to desire to engage in another bureaucratic process against an insurer. So difficult. If CDI, DMHC wanted to continue this kind of a process, perhaps they should have shifted the burden or thought about shifting the burden of proof away from the victim and made the insurer have the burden of proof. And again, going back to the simplicity nature, lump sum payments might have been a better deal and actually made the insurers pay for the harm they actually created. Finally, standardization. There are a lot of overlapping terms, variations abounded. This is a result of negotiations between DMHC, CDI, and insurers rather than a simple mandate of standard terms. So CDI, DMHC might want to consider rather mandating specific uniform terms of the settlement and recoupment, true independent third-party review underwritten by insurers but run by a government agency. This is what the FDA does, for example. And the use of DMHC CDI designated standard application forms. That might have provided applicants with a simpler system now and in the future, as well as in the past, to determine their eligibility and their obligations. So overall, rescission victim settlements were very complex, didn't take into account the rescission victim's perspective as much as it could have. Compounding this were the communications issues, problems with feedback, complicated victim recovery systems, and the lack of standardization. Unfortunately, with respect to these rescissions, the insurance companies really won. 95% or more of these victims didn't participate, and therefore that inures directly to the consumers, the insurer's benefit rather than the consumer. And given the fact that the insurance companies more recently have unapologetically said they will rely on rescission both here and in the federal government, their massive profits and high rate increases, it's ever more important that we make sure that DMHC and CDI have the tools to aggressively police and penalize these recalcitrant healthcare insurers. That concludes my testimony. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm sure you'll have a lot of questions, Assemblywoman. No, Vice Chair Strickland.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Of those that lost their insurance and then had the opportunity to then again sign on with the company that rescinded them, how many enrolled with other plans?
I don't know the answer to that question. I don't know.
How many received health care through new employment?
Oh, I'm assuming you're referring to Daryl Eng's statements in the LA Times. We don't know. No one does. No one knows.
Okay. How many are seeking redress through the legal process?
Right now, we're seeing about 1,300 people that have signed up for the various class actions outside of HealthNet. HealthNet already is done. So around 1,300. But
and how many were reconciled through the HealthNet lawsuit?
800.
So 2,100 are seeking redress through the legal process. An unknown number have enrolled with other plans. Some perhaps have received health coverage through different employment. What's that total number then?
We don't know. I don't know, and I don't think anyone knows. We don't have a real good sense of that because there hasn't been any, again, there's no feedback system to go and re-ask the question, are you back in the system? Have you got insurance? Is there a server that we put out? There's nothing.
Is it possible that someone might have just not wanted to get insurance after their experience?
If they're ill, I'm assuming no.
Is it possible?
I doubt it. I don't think so. I think that if you are in a situation where you're faced with $250,000 worth of costs and it's your child, you're going to go after that any way you can. And you may not be successful, but you definitely are going to try. And this is why healthcare reform right now is getting bantied about in all different directions, because we don't know who will be the ones who will sign up on the way to the hospital. And who are the ones who say, I want it now so I can protect my family and so forth. It's just very difficult to parse out those numbers.
I would definitely agree with you. And so some of your statements are rather sweeping in your conclusions as to how ineffective the process has been. And to preface, I don't think it's fair or appropriate for anyone to get their coverage revoked simply because they are now accessing the services that they have paid for. But it is fully appropriate when someone has deliberately set out to fraud, a willful misrepresentation, and someone lies on their application in order to get that coverage. And I think your assertion that this needed to be done through the legal process is hardly the most effective way to come to some sort of reasonable resolution. You know, when the plaintiffs sue, they will have years and years before they're ever able to recover damages, assuming that it goes in their direction. Then all of their uncompensated costs that have come out of their pocket, still without health insurance. I mean, it seems to me that looking at this, that there seems to be a lot of good faith negotiation in trying to come to a speedy resolution for those that were aggrieved, so that they wouldn't have to linger in a rather lengthy legal process. So could you pull up that last slide again?
Just to respond to some of your comments, I did not assume that the legal system is the best way of doing it. In fact, I assume it's not the best way of doing it. I do not believe private litigation is the way to recompense or get justice to these individuals. I think, in fact, DMHC and CDR are the very people to do this, and I have supported their activities all the way from the beginning, hoping that this would get done rather than making somebody go through a set of tort suits. I think that's not the way to go. It's way too onerous. Now, given that, I would also indicate that Healthy HealthNet litigation only took 17 months. So when you're talking about 17 months versus somebody who's been rescinded in 2004, it's now 2010. Theoretically, their stuff would have to wait 5 years before they actually got justice. So, again, I definitely do not like the legal system of going through individual cases, because if you got into a system and the individual got justice, that doesn't help the same exact person who has the same exact issues but doesn't have a lawyer. So I agree with you. Individual litigation is not the way to go here. Very inefficient. But what we have to do is think, if we can come up with a standard or the success level of Bill Chernoff, I think we should be happy about that. I think we should say, well, we're doing just as good of a job, and you know what? You don't have to pay a third or 40% of your fees to him. So I agree with that. I'm just hoping that through this process of reflection that we can figure out a better way to make those percentage numbers of participants much
higher.
But
the problem is you still don't actually have an accurate picture of what those percentages are, because you can't account for folks who've been insured under other plans. If you felt wronged by Blue Cross and so you signed up with Health Net, you don't have any idea what those numbers are. You don't have any idea who's gotten insurance under perhaps new employment. You don't have any idea in terms of all those who are seeking redress through the legal process. So you don't even have a good picture, which I see is your argument for a feedback component, but nonetheless making the accusation that these plans have failed miserably at trying to
I'm not making accusations. I'm just pointing out, let the numbers speak for themselves.
But that's the conclusion that you're drawing without all of the facts. Can you please pull up your last slide?
Actually, it's not. I am giving you information that is publicly available and available from DMHC. So you really, if you're going to level that accusation against me, you need to level it against them too, because they themselves don't know how many people actually participated. So I think what we have to do is say, why don't we know? Rather than saying, you know, you're just this independent witness. Why aren't you? Why you can't make those conclusions? I would say, well, let's look at what we have, and then take a step from there. How do we find out more?
You're using a lot of very subjective terminology that I think reflects not necessarily an unbiased perspective and an analysis of the facts. So, I mean, given your last conclusion here, how many rescissions have been? How many rescissions have there been since the agreements were come to by CDI, DMHC, and the health plans?
So are you talking about rescissions during 2004 to 2008 or 2009, 2010?
After the settlement agreements were put into place.
I actually don't know the answer to that, except I know that the Secretary Bonner indicated that it's been reduced by 80-something percent. The challenge with that number is we don't know how that was derived. So I'd personally like to know how that was derived.
Okay. That number is 9. So since the settlement agreements.
How do you know?
Because they'll come up and testify in just a second.
So wait. So you're telling me that they know for sure that of 26 million Californians and the 6 million in the universe of individual health insurance, 9 were rescinded.
Is now an appropriate time to bring them up so they can answer that question?
Let's finish with this witness. You can hold that question for them.
So given that your conclusion here says that they have an unapologetic reliance upon rescission, massive profits, high rate increases, they need to aggressively police and penalize recalcitrant health insurers. And so my question is if we have been able to reduce the number of rescissions to 9 since 2008, summer of 2008. So do you, in your mind, if that is actually a real number, that it's 9, do you feel that then the settlement agreements have been successful in changing the policy?
Absolutely not. You've got all those people, the 6,000 people, with only a handful that got justice. That was one of the stated goals. Secretary Bonner said, we've got to get justice for these people that have been wronged. And if you assume $10,000 a person, which is just on the basis of the numbers that we have, 6,000 people, that's $60 million that hasn't been paid out. That's a lot of money. I mean, if it covers my student loan debt, it's a lot of money. And that covers my student loan debt.
And I don't mean to question that that's not a large sum of money to most folks. I was just curious though, but in terms of a prospective look forward, do you feel that the system has been modified in such a way that it does justice to those who have complaints, and the rescission process, it has the appropriate checks and balances through CDI and DMHC in order to protect the consumer?
I don't think so. I mean, I would ask the following questions. If it were me, I'd first want to know more behind the data, both the data that you're mentioning as well as the data that was provided to the committee. I would want to really know how those figures were determined.
Is there a rescission? Isn't there a rescission? Yes or no? I mean, how many rescissions you had in the last year and a half?
I'm that would be more the dynamic process. So, for example, what was the standard of success? What was the, you always have to.
Okay, I have a question. I mean, obviously we have two different issues here in terms of our prospective protection for the consumer, as well as how do we go about addressing those who were as a result of the settlement agreements. So my question is about prospective.
Okay, prospective, I would ask, are you satisfied? Is this committee satisfied? Is DMHC and CDI satisfied with the participation in the previous settlement so that if rescission becomes an issue again, will we just put the exact same system into place? That's my question. If we're going to look at this as a prospective matter, I'd be very concerned if we use the same identical system for the future.
But if that system has been put into place and since July of 2008 we've had 9 rescissions, it would seem to me that at least DMHC and CDI have been somewhat successful in making sure that our health plans are held accountable for how they do business. I mean, that's just, we can move on, but anyway, we'll stop there.
Thank you. Assemblymember Arambola.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think we're in danger of losing focus here. I think the focus is on the performance of these departments and how they carry out their functions. Now, as I understand, these departments conducted investigations. They also received complaints from individuals who felt that they had been wronged in the termination of their coverage. My concern is with making sure that we aggressively go after bad apples, because they make things bad for the good players. And, I don't know what happened to those letters and why some people didn't respond. You know, the vice chair mentioned possibly they got a job. I would point out this is in 2008 and 2009, the worst recession since the Great Depression. It's more likely that they had lost their home and been forced out. And as I understand, they had 90 days to respond. And if they didn't respond, they lost their rights. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Now, part of the purpose for going after these illegal actions of rescission, I assume, is to level the playing field so that good operators are not adversely affected. In other words, if there's somebody who is following the law, if there's a company following the law, and there's a company that isn't, by illegally rescinding these insurance contracts, then the illegal operator is getting a benefit. They are not paying out claims that they would otherwise have to, and they are at a competitive advantage compared to those that are operating legally. So what can we do going forward to make sure that we even the playing field so that all insurance companies are doing what they are supposed to do? Is there anything that we need to do with this particular situation where it appears the two state departments for which we are responsible and have oversight responsibility may have carried out this agreement in a way that was not fully available to all of the individuals? And it seems to me that the state agencies found, in some instances, a practice where employees of the insurance company were given bonuses or incentives for rescinding contracts. Why could they not have given bonuses to their employees for implementing this agreement?
Well, that's certainly an innovative solution, actually giving bonuses or paying people to actually implement the settlement. I had certainly not thought of that at all. I think it'd be an interesting perception, and perhaps I'll steal your idea and write an academic article on it. But I think the key here is a joint regulatory process and having CDI and DMHC perhaps cross that imaginary line and work together and as a body and work and say to the insurers, let's have a uniform system of settlement, and this is how we're going to do it. And rather than negotiating with each and every insurer, which then creates variability. I would also strongly suggest, because I know that folks at DMHC, I don't know personally if whether CDI have these people, but I know DMHC have people that can write these applications. And if we had a single application that was formulated and then subsequently vetted and then implemented, again, a single form, very similar to what happened in the real estate industry, where we implemented a series of standardized forms that greased the wheels of commerce, made everyone understand what their role was and what their responsibilities were. I think that would go a long way to help, both in terms of the consumer, but also the insurer. They would know what they were responsible for, and as well the agencies and this body. They would know what to expect and how to actually interpret what these rules are and these forms, what these forms mean. So I think uniformity would really help, and a joint effort between CDI and DMHC.
Assemblymember Valines. Okay. Assemblymember Hagman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I know we're here to check on systems, and I like systems. I like changing systems, and I think government has a long way to go to fix systems. Your presentation today was, in my opinion, a little biased toward a conclusionary type of statement. And when you come back and ask some of these questions, I'm still confused back in the pages where you start off with the premise, X amount of letters sent out, and we don't know if someone didn't confirm by actually doing a proactive thing, which is send something back in the mail versus them getting it, that's a failure, okay, because we have a certain amount. We don't know the address has changed. We don't know if they have decided and maybe they called up attorney, wrote a threatening letter, and they went with like this separate health plan.
Right.
We don't know what happened. And when we start off with that premise way up there, that the rest of the data, we don't know what kind of conclusions we could draw from it, because obviously there's not enough data that was actually extrapolated. We need to go back and survey every one of these people and say what really did happen from 2004, 2005, 2006. Find out, did they get another job? Did they get another insurance? Did they switch over? Did the insurance company take care of it? Did they go in a lawsuit? What did happen with it? By then, we can have real conclusions, really, because it's kind of, you know, you start off with that, you come up with a conclusion, only 5% or 17% got, you know, was righted, and everybody else was wronged by this process. And we honestly don't know that that's the case. I'm just wondering, what kind of steps can we take, maybe through our two state agencies, to go back and maybe refollow up with these you know, 6,000 cases or so, and find out what really did happen? Because if we're going to start changing systems completely, we got to make sure we have accurate information. Did it really stop at that first letter? And then we just raw off the whole system. Like you said, if you have a major illness and you're going through hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of liability, you would think that everyone would go through the process, even if it came in late, because they're probably still in lawsuits or losing their houses or something. Right. This you know, 3, 4, 5 years longer. We all been in that private sector. We know where those bills stack up.
Right.
Doesn't make a sense. This does not add up to what was out there with these conclusionary data here. And then to come off and all these reasons why, because the health plans are bad and they're making profit and all that kind of stuff, those are conclusions based on these facts that we don't know really what happened there. One of the suggestions I have, Mr. Chair, is when we get to our testimony, if there's been any follow-up with these since the initial letter gone out and just responding to people filling out the applications coming back, because otherwise we really don't know. They could have just, you know, that one injury could have got them out of a job, they got another job, they got new health insurance, that one's taken care of it. Or it could have gone through the public system and been taken care of. We don't know what happened. And that's why I'm saying it's hard for me to sit there and change systems without really having, this is obvious, we need to go this way or that way. And God knows this government needs it. We need a lot of system changes. And I'm one of the first ones to step up with it. It's hard to do that from what you presented so far.
Well, let me just respond. DMHC and CDI did make an effort to try and follow up. I mean, they actually mandated some follow-up in DMHC and mandated follow-up, and they looked to see if they could find these people. There are certain systems in place to try to get them, but we didn't get any information. And again, my information I'm taking
sure, it's just you what know, you were given.
What I was given, right.
Conclusions from that.
So that's what I'm trying to bring up. But I think what's really important is what you raised. One of the systems issues is we need a feedback system. We need to really determine what's happening so that we can make the right adjustments, because obviously you squeeze the balloon in one place, it kind of sticks up someplace else. we do have to do that, and that's hopefully what we're going to try to get to here today, in seeing if we can actually find out what did work, what didn't work, and then subsequently move forward from there. But I totally agree with you. The numbers are all we have are those numbers. So let's dig deeper and figure out what we can do.
It's hard to make conclusions from these numbers at this point, and some of those conclusions are already made in the presentation. I think we need to get more dig into it first before we come out with certain conclusions.
Thank you. Vice Chair Strickland.
I can't really tell here if this has been an indictment of health plans or if our goal is to actually perform some sort of analysis of how two state agencies perform during a very serious policy negotiation. And given the track record of this committee, I would assume it's the latter, and that's what the chair has sort of set up our way of doing business here, so that we can come together and in a bipartisan way make recommendations to state agencies so that they can perhaps perform their jobs a little bit better. I think, frankly, that we need to look at setting up standards for measurement when we have these types of negotiations, regardless of what state agency we're dealing with, to determine whether or not these settlement agreements or other agreements that are negotiated have successfully been implemented, setting up mile markers along the way, defining what expectations are and timelines and those kind of things, so that there is no ambiguity between our state departments and then the folks that they've negotiated with, in this case, the health plans, so that there are outcomes to look at. There are, timelines that can be realized, but it's unfair if that wasn't stipulated in any part of the settlement agreement to then say, well, now you need to, do X, Y, and Z. I mean, it seems to me that would have been a key part of the execution of this is, okay, this is what we found, this is how you rectify it, and this is what you'll do going forward. And once everybody comes to that decision, I mean, the agreements are done, they are, they've been executed. So going forward, we need to find out what we can recommend as a committee to various departments and agencies when they are in, they do need to come into settle agreements with folks, that these are our recommendations for what you pursue. And I think that, some of the conclusions up here are in direct contrast to what many of us support through legislation, through what this body has chosen to not pass in the legislature, because we don't support the state government taking over the private industry of healthcare, and things like setting up, one type of document and regulating exactly, what company has to do what in order to ensure folks and carry out business in this state. So, there are a lot of sort of anti-free market issues that we're looking at here. And I'm not an apologist for any health plan who is going to illegally rescind coverage for anyone. But I think that we need to take a look at how difficult it is to do business in this state. We need to take a look at how we can incentivize more plans to come to this state, to take a look at the mandates we put on our health plans. How do we go about expanding access, expanding coverage, reducing costs? I mean, those are tremendous things that we need to look at so that more people can have access to the system, more people can be covered. And I think that's all of our goals here. And that's a part of a larger system that we need to address as we approach healthcare reform as a state and obviously as a country. But I appreciate the chairman's efforts to try to help provide some guidance to our state agencies looking forward and how they're going to address future incidents. Thank you.
Thank you. And I want to make clear, my goal with this is not to look at the settlements themselves. Those were entered into. They are what they are. Maybe a policy committee could get focused on that. For us, those settlements were done by the two departments, not by us. And so what this hearing is focused on is their performance on their settlements. That's what this hearing is about. It's about what they entered into and their follow-through. So some of the questions that we're getting here in terms of, we don't know the data, or how do we know this? Well, it's clear that the flaw isn't here or with us. It's with the departments. They're the ones who set up the settlements, and they're the ones who have been managing them over the last couple of years. So let's focus on performance in following through on settlements that they entered into. Assemblymember Arambola.
Thank you again, Mr. Chairman. You know, sometimes I'm an attorney, I'll confess. and I will contest that attorneys oftentimes don't speak English, so maybe they're part of that 40%. But I hear a lot that we should do something about attorneys being involved in a number of fields, whether it's medical malpractice or, in this particular case, with what appears to be a clear breach of contract when somebody agreed to pay the premium and then did not receive what they were promised in exchange. Now, one option might be to have this revert to the private bar. But I thought I heard you say that you didn't think that was the preferable approach, and I tend to agree. I think it ought to be dealt with administratively. I think it's better addressed that way. But the two departments that have statutory oversight authority, they need to operate within some rulemaking process. And as I understand, the Department of Managed Health Care does not have any regulations on how to deal with rescissions. Is that correct?
That's correct. They started joint activities with CDI and then gave up the rulemaking process, and CDI is going to be introducing theirs in, I believe, this year, soon.
So here we have a situation where we say attorneys, butt out, stay out of this. We'll take care of it. And then there's no procedures for how to deal with it. Some folks came together and crafted this claims process. The claims process apparently did not reach a vast majority of the people that it was intended to reach, that had been found to have been wronged by the insurance companies.
Or at least one out of five to one out of six. They didn't, okay. Definitely didn't reach, or that's the numbers that we have. Right?
Okay. And I may be jumping ahead, Mr. Chairman, but I fully agree with the requests that would require the departments to provide us the information. They are the ones that have the responsibility to provide that information and have not done so. They don't have a process yet for how to deal with these instances in the future. And it seems to me that that ought to be where we concentrate our attention. And one thing that helps to concentrate attention is money. So I would agree with your recommendation that we zero out their budget until they provide some information that's requested on how, you know, because we can argue, is somebody shading it this way or that way, but until we have the information and until the people that are required to provide the information, then we're just spinning our wheels. And my final comment is, I think doctors have a motto, first do no harm. I think we should apply that to insurance companies also, because they were leaving people in a lurch. They were leaving people, you know, in a gurney, going into the emergency room. Oops, you don't have insurance. And worst of all, these folks that were without coverage could no longer get coverage because of the very fact they'd gotten ill, which was why they were paying premiums in the first place. So I think we need to redouble our efforts to make sure that our state's administrative agencies that have responsibility for this are doing their job in the most effective manner.
Thank you. Assemblymember Lowenthal.
Please let me know if this has already been asked and answered. Why did the departments pursue settlements instead of regulatory proceedings that would have allowed full disclosure of the rescissions?
As far as I know, as far as I know, just on the basis of reading the public press, it was to avoid a long drawn out process that would be more expensive for the state and would not have theoretically gotten enough as many victims their their recompense or re-enrollment.
And do you know how they determine the appropriate fines?
No, I do not. I do not.
So that's something we can try to follow up on?
And they're still out there to come up and answer questions.
And
as well.
Do you know if Blue Cross paid the $1 million fine that Department of Managed Health Care announced in 2007?
According to the records that were provided to us, all fines have been collected, but there was that AP article that said that they had not collected. So I don't know the absolute answer to that question either. I'm sorry.
Just one more, and I'm sure you're eager to get on with this. Why did the Department of Insurance take more than 10 months to send the letters out? Did you?
Again, not within my bailiwick. I do not know the answer to that question. I'm sure that there's a reasonable explanation from CDI.
And last but not least, forgive my ignorance, but when insurers have to pay out settlements, where does that money come from? Does that come from their profits? Do they have some sort of liability insurance that they take out from some other company that pays for those settlements? Where does that money come from?
My own experience in this, but it's not necessarily in California, is that they do have insurance and reinsurance for these settlements so that they actually pay out a certain percentage up to a certain level of liability, and then a reinsurance carrier kicks in and pays the rest.
I want to thank you for how comprehensive your report was, and I'm just absolutely horrified by the inability of our state departments to find the people that I believe lost a portion of their lives by these rescissions. Thank you so much for your work.
Thank you very much.
Thank Assemblymember Lyons, did you still have a question?
Yeah, I do. Just it's a quick question based on Mr. Rambo's
mic. Talk into the mic.
It's just I would have got it. Thanks. Just a quick question based on Mr. Rambo's question and the dialogue you guys had. Could it be, and I don't know, DMHE is going to come up here, did they maybe just defer to CDI? Is CDI basically becoming the standard for trying to track these down? I mean, can that be a reason why? I mean, let me just be very clear, even though I think Juan is a registered independent, I'm still kind of looking at him as a little bit of a Democrat. When I hear him say he wants to zero out a budget, I say, great, okay. we should do that in more places. And in fact, Californians would do it to us in a heartbeat too, so we should reflect on that. But could it just be that they didn't have the resources they need, or could it be that they're working with CDI to say, let them take the lead on it? I mean, I don't know the answer, because I cannot imagine that DMHC just sat there and did absolutely nothing. And so the specific question is CDI, based on your analysis, the becoming the standard for them to go track down and find these folks? And the second one is, I would just make a quick comment that I'm sure you want to respond to. It goes back to Ms. Strickland and your conversation. I do think, while you have a lot of data, your last slide clearly shows a bias against insurance companies. Your last statement clearly takes your report, and if anyone's looking at it, you know, just in a vacuum, they say, okay, this person's an apologist for the other side and clearly against them. And I would think you have some data you want out there that you should clean that up. And I think really that's the dialogue you guys were having, is because when you read the last little bit, it's clear as a bell that what are the exact words you use? The recalcitrant insurance companies who are all bad and evil and go away or something. Maybe I meant those words.
I don't use the four-letter word. No.
So that was just a comment. I was going to do it earlier, but I didn't want to ruin the dialogue you guys were having. And maybe that's what's going on. And then CDI is going to come up and testify too, because the key is, and Mr. Hagman said it, we just want to find out what happened. I suspect it's a combination of what Mr. Rambula said. People have lost houses or they've moved on. Frankly, they could have left California. Others have gotten work and are now enrolled in some other program, and many just simply don't have health care. And we need to find out exactly what is the reason. I mean, because nobody leaves money sitting on the table. And as somebody who's watched, has had to go through watching somebody be very sick and very long and deal with all kinds of bills and just try to figure out your payments, it could actually easily happen that you get another envelope and you look and you don't even know it, saying you have a chance to get money. You may just throw it out because it's just another thing you can't deal with while somebody's dying from cancer. So there's a balance there, but we need to, that's what we're trying to achieve.
All right, first, with respect to CDI and DMHC, I don't know the answer to the question whether CDI is becoming the kind of lead agency. But, of course, they have differing bailiwicks. You know, CDI is traditionally the traditional indemnity insurers, so they're really going to be very different than DMHC, which is managed care. So I don't know I don't know the answer to that question, but I suppose they could be taking themes, and that's something they can talk about. But legally speaking, they have different jurisdictions. With respect to the analysis and kind of the four-letter word beginning with E, evil, or the four-letter word beginning with F, fair, I do agree to a certain extent that what I've been talking about is observations of the health insurance industry. I've been doing this for 25 years now, and the challenges, and believe it or not, I am an independent, and I used to work in the private healthcare sector, so I do understand the pain. The challenge is that I know, as you might guess, people who have had significant disease from minority groups, vulnerable patient populations that were rescinded, and right, no, I know, I realize that, and it also happened to a family member, so I do understand that. The question really is, what's the response? And if the response of the insurer is, we made a boo-boo, we're going to fix it, that's one thing. But it's another when they say, well, you didn't report that you took Avalox 6 years ago, and now you have breast cancer, which the two have nothing to do with each other. Now we're going to pull your policy. That's a real challenge, and I really don't think that that's an appropriate way of an insurance company to act. So that's why I have my own personal comments about it. But I will take your comments to heart. I will axe that last slide, and I'll just present the data.
And also following on that, on what you were saying, well, first of all, I think that's great. I think that would be helpful to you when you present. Second is that, I mean, basically, in effect, aren't these settlements or insurance companies admitting that they made that mistake? What we're really asking here is, why didn't it trickle down to the individual? Why didn't they get it? I mean, really, right, your answer, your question is answered by them saying, we did make a mistake and we're willing to do this. Here's a settlement. We just need to find out, why aren't these folks in California actually getting that settlement or using it?
Well, actually, they didn't admit it. They are saying expressly in all of their on their websites as well as in the letters, this does not constitute any admission of liability or any admission of wrongdoing. So that's pretty express. But they are, you know, perhaps trying to get recompense. So let's see what happens.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Liang. I did want to point out he didn't say it, but he is an MD and JD, so he can sue himself at any time.
I can sue and get be my own expert witness, so that works well.
Thank you very much. We have also with us actually what I thought was going to be I thought this was just going to be a short intro before the actual folks who are doing the implementation. We have David Link, Deputy Commissioner and Legislative Director for the California Department of Insurance. Timothy Labasse, Assistant Deputy Director, Office of Legal Services, Department of Managed Healthcare. Amy Daubertine, Assistant Deputy Director, Office of Enforcement, Department of Managed Healthcare. And Marcy Gallagher, Senior Counsel and Chief Division of Health Plan Surveys, Department of Managed Healthcare. Welcome. Okay. We'll start with David, since there's only one of you, and then we'll go to DMHC.
Oh, thank you. My name is David Link. I'm Deputy Commissioner at the Department of Insurance. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing. I think we all agree that the individual health insurance market is broken and must be fixed. The problem of health insurance rescissions throws a spotlight on the dysfunction. About two-thirds of us get our health insurance from our employers and never have to worry about filling out a questionnaire about our health status or having our insurance taken away because we get sick. Another 12% of Californians are seniors and get their insurance through Medicare, also without medical underwriting or fear of rescission. Roughly 16% are poor and covered through the state's various welfare programs, such as Medi-Cal and Healthy Families. The state, too, does not require them to document their health history to qualify, nor will it drop their coverage because of health claims. But that is exactly what 6.8% of Californians do have to face in the individual market. It's easy for all of us to underestimate or ignore how frustrating and discouraging that can be. And that is one of the factors that drives 6.6 million people in the state to simply forego health insurance entirely. At CDI, we began to see the problem of rescissions in our 2005 investigation of Blue Shield. Over the next 3 years, we intensified our efforts in more targeted market conduct examinations, and in 2008, the press brought the issue to the public's attention. In our settlements, we made sure every rescinded consumer had specific remedies to choose from. Everyone whose contract was rescinded was given an offer of new coverage without any underwriting. However, we also wanted to make sure consumers could preserve their right to pursue legal action on their own if they wished, and made that option clear to them. If they chose not to pursue private legal action, we guaranteed that they could demand their insurer pay for all health bills they should have paid under the contract. Those provisions are binding on every affected insurer and for every person whose health insurance was rescinded between 2004 and 2008. Our settlements, as well as DMHC's and the city attorney's, have forced insurers to change their behavior. And in 2 months, CDI's rescission regulations will become effective and provide us an additional set of tools to deal with the problem. As long as we have an underwritten individual market, we will use every means at our disposal to make sure every insurer follows the laws we do have in both letter and spirit. Thank you.
Thank you. Are all three of you going to speak, or is one going to take the lead, and then you'll be available to
questions? Just me, Mr. Chair.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Mr. Labasse.
Yeah. Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members. My name is Tim Labasse, and I'm an Assistant Deputy Director at the California Department of Managed Health Care, and I'm joined this morning by Amy Daubertine, the Assistant Deputy Director and Chief of our Enforcement Office, as well as Marcy Gallagher, the Chief of our Health Plan Division within the DMHC Help Center. Thank you for inviting us this morning to present on the actions that the department has taken relating to rescissions. As a result of DMHC actions, the number of rescissions industry-wide has dropped from 1,553 in 2005 to less than 10 in the last 2 years, as shown by the chart behind you. The department has also assessed and collected $13.6 million in penalties, the highest by any agency in the nation, for illegal rescissions. We've required health plans to offer guaranteed coverage to more than 3,400 enrollees, and we've returned more than $870,000 in expenses to consumers in a matter of months. The department's actions to halt illegal rescissions have been comprehensive, swift, and binding. Moreover, all of the Department of Managed Health Care's actions were designed to carefully balance the need to ensure that not only those consumers who were unfairly rescinded were protected, but that all consumers in the individual market would have access to affordable health care coverage. Despite the well-documented practice of post-claims underwriting and rescission that surfaced in 2006, early court cases that were brought against health plans simply did not provide the long-term relief that consumers expected and deserved. As the initial proposed rescission court settlements were being made public, our director was extremely concerned that deals were being struck quickly without putting the consumer first. Instead, they seemed to provide no real benefit for the consumer, other than a small one-time payout. Therefore, in early 2007, our department became the first agency in the nation to take serious action to end the practice of illegal rescissions. The department's war on rescission resulted in unprecedented actions and strong new consumer protections that have forever changed the California health plan industry. These actions also had such a profound impact that they changed the industry practices across the nation. In short, the net effect of our enforcement and consumer protection actions have already produced the major changes in the health plan industry demanded by consumer groups and in the pending Department of Insurance draft regulations. These industry changes include clearer, understandable application forms to obtain accurate information and capture each individual's responses, clear disclosure statements so consumers understand their rights and obligations, broker and applicant attestations to ensure and verify and complete understanding of the application and disclosures, more complete medical underwriting of individual policies prior to issuance, resolution of all reasonable questions pertaining to prior medical conditions before issuing coverage, notice to consumers that an investigation has commenced, the reasons for the investigation, and an invitation to provide explanations, documentation requirements to demonstrate the completion of medical underwriting and the basis for any actions resulting from the investigation, and a fair and partial grievance process for consumers. In addition, throughout the settlement period, consumers retain the ability to choose a private cause of action instead of the remedies provided to them by our agency. These industry changes prompted by the enforcement actions have been continually monitored by the DMHC and are well underway to implementation within all five plans, covering essentially all of the individual market in California under our jurisdiction. Moreover, the DMHC has initiated follow-up surveys of each plan to ensure these reforms are appropriately implemented. The administration's goal throughout these investigations and reforms has been to offer coverage to as many as possible, as quickly as possible, and to reform the industry practices so that consumers receive a fair review of their application up front. It is important to also point out that the law still allows for rescission in some circumstances. As we have seen in recent court cases, some rescissions do involve misrepresentations on the part of consumers when filling out their health history questionnaires. In a market that will continue to have a need to rescind coverage at times, the department was able to demand a fair and balanced rescission process, which is vital to protect all consumers from unfairly subsidizing higher premiums resulting from those who may represent their health status. Given the volatile nature of the individual market and the soaring costs of health care coverage, the DMHC could not in good conscience make a difficult market even worse. But the need for this type of delicate balance once again illustrates the need for the type of meaningful health care reform contained in the governor's and former speaker's 2007 legislative proposal. These reforms would have provided guaranteed issue of coverage, regardless of a person's health status, and would have eliminated the need for medical underwriting. Thank you for your time this morning, and we can respond to any questions the committee may have.
Okay. I'll get started, since I don't see anybody raising their hand. It's interesting how folks were just ready to ask questions of the previous person. The issue of the letters going out, the letters from DMHC went out a couple of months after the settlement. The letters from CDI went out 10 months after. DMHC asked for the letter, sent out the letters under their own letterhead, correct? And CDI had the insurers send out the letters. So if you could each in turn explain to us why the discrepancy between the two approaches, why a department-driven process as opposed to an insurer-driven process, and the timing, that the delay that it took to write a letter to folks saying you're eligible for this. Either one.
I'll start. With respect to the 10 months, that was, I believe, the Health Net case that was involved in litigation. And one of the problems that we face here is that I have not had the advantage of looking at Mr. Lang's presentation, and I know that he never asked for the courtesy of meeting with CDI staff. So this is the first time that I've seen him, and I know that CDI's attorneys would disagree very vociferously with his, I think it's an assumption, that our lawyers did not, in fact, spend time on these letters. In fact, they thought about this long and hard. They worked with both other lawyers, with outside lawyers, and tried to make these as clear as possible. While his characterization of them as being long is in fact correct in general, the beginning of the letter is about one or two pages describing as clearly as possible what the options are. The rest of it is necessarily in legal language to make sure they are legally binding in a court of law on the insurers as well as for the consumers. That is a difficult process. It's regrettable that we are involved in a very complicated legal process here, but that was, in fact, the reality. We did not desire any long length of time in order to do this. We wanted to make sure that we spent the time we needed to make them as clear as possible.
Two follow-ups. One, the Blue Shield letters went out 12 months later. That wasn't involved in the Health Net litigation. And two, again, the decision that was made at CDI to have the letters go out by the insurer not by the Department of Insurance.
So, and that was a difference in philosophy here. We were we debated that ourselves about whether consumers would trust the government more than the insurer that they were dealing with.
And you decided to go with the insurer that had just rescinded them?
Well,
you thought that was going to get them excited?
That's the person that they were dealing with, and that would in fact be responsible. But in any event, it does not seem to have made any difference one way or the other with respect to the response rates, which is your concern.
That
seem to have weighed one way or the
other. In terms of the outside attorneys that you said that your attorneys were working with.
Other attorneys, not outside attorneys. This was within CDI, other attorneys within CDI.
You said outside. So I assume because the letters went out on the letterhead of the insurance companies, that your lawyers were talking to their lawyers.
It was a negotiated settlement, and the wording
after the
of
settlement
the letters,
was done, in terms of the letter itself.
Yeah, the wording of the letters was going to be part of the settlement, so they continued working with them on those.
DMHC?
With regard to the letters, we did choose to put them out on our letterhead so that they could see a neutral regulatory face on that letter instead of receiving a letter from the health plan who just rescinded them. They all went out by September of the year 2008 when all of the settlements were reached. They were all reached between May and August of 2008. All of them went out by September and October 2008. And equally, we took the time to make sure we ran them by the UC Berkeley Health Research for Action. They are literacy experts. We took the time to make sure that they would be clear, legible, readable to an average consumer. And we also had to take the time to make sure they were thorough and complete with regard to all of their rights.
Okay. Fines. The status on fines. How much did you collect from each of the five insurers, and when did you collect any fines? Any monetary compensation that was paid, or penalties? Anything that could be in that purview? I may not be using the right terminology, but anything that you received from the insurance companies as a result of these settlements?
We collected, on behalf of DMHC, $13.6 million. Every penny was received within 15 days of reaching the settlement agreement. Okay. From five different health plans.
Okay. CDI?
I know we got, I believe it was $3.6 million from HealthNet, and an additional million from, I believe it was Blue Shield.
Blue Cross. And you got zero from Blue Shield.
That's correct.
And so you only had three. You had HealthNet, Blue Shield, Blue Cross.
Correct.
Where, just to be clear here, Department of Managed Health Care had HealthNet, PacifiCare, Blue Cross, Blue Shield, and Kaiser. Is there a reason why Blue Shield, you got 3.6 and one out of the two insurers, million, and then you didn't get anything from Blue Shield? Were they?
Those were part of the negotiations among the lawyers, and they depend on the facts of each particular case.
And it was also the last of the three. The settlement date for Blue Shield was December of 2008, much later than the other two settlements.
Correct.
Okay. Assemblymember Valines, I'm sorry.
Thank you. I just kind of a process question going back to the first presentation, and honestly I was trying to skim through. I forget the numbers, and they were relatively small numbers of people that didn't respond at all. Once the and this is for both, I guess, once these letters go out, is it, you know, how do you know, how do you evaluate or audit, you know, sitting here, like some actually showed interest but then didn't go forward? I'm curious what that meant. Why would somebody must have sent an initial letter and said, yeah, I'm interested in this about the settlement, but then they didn't do anything. I mean, do we do some kind of breakdown audit to find out, you know, what were the different reasons people responded differently? And also those that we couldn't find, that's really what I'd like to hear. And because there can only be so much you can do. You can't go track down people and hire CSI to go find people. I get that. But, you know, are we simply sending out a letter and saying, if we don't hear from you in 90 days, we're done with you? I mean, is there something that we're doing more than that? Because I think that's sort of that's really what we're trying to get at today is, you know, where's that trust factor of, are people really being reached out to? And people feel like, you know, oh, nobody, you know, no one told me. I'm sure that all those people didn't respond, said nobody told me. Maybe some letters actually were received. Maybe many weren't. I mean, what do we do to actually find that out so we don't have that problem again?
The DMHC took the extra step of using Federal Express to provide these letters by overnight mail so that we would know exactly who received them and who and what letters came back returned. FedEx tracks those, and they helped us track those. Then we used an independent administrative mail house that had 25 years of experience in dealing with class actions to not only keep track of those letters that had been returned, but to do skip trace and do further research on everything that they could use. And this is their job. They've been doing it for 25 years to find everyone that returned a letter. So those extra means were utilized to find all of the consumers.
Bounce back.
Correct.
Bounce back on it.
I would assume
this is probably a little unfair of a question for you. I would assume these houses probably get paid on those people they do find in those lawsuit cases, right? I mean, they're professionals at finding people.
That's
that
right.
Okay, that's what I thought.
So when you ask about the
load. What happened after that? I'm sorry. I interrupted you. You were going. So they then go out and do their skip search, you called it.
Correct.
And then what happens?
They find another address and they send the letter out to the current address. So those numbers are after the skip trace has been performed on each and every one of the enrollees population for each of the five plans.
Got it.
So those are good numbers.
Seems
about
pretty extensive to me. That's fair. What about CDI?
So our process was not dissimilar. The insurers did it, but they had to send out the first letter, return receipt, and the anything that came back without a receipt then went to a second level of review to find somebody, to an independent company to find them. And that is, and it's important to focus on that. Our goal was to make sure we had negotiated an offer for every one of the rescinded people. That offer is in fact binding on every individual and every insurer. In a mobile culture like the one we have, there's always going to be a certain number of people that you sure. can't find, and that is in fact a problem. With respect to the ones who did get it, though, and that was the vast majority in both cases, people then will make the decisions that they feel are best for them. The question of whether we articulated the choices that we had negotiated for them well is certainly a good one, and we're always happy to look at that again. But the fact is that we tried to make that as clear as possible for everybody, and then they could make the decision that they thought was best for them.
Okay, just to end, if I can, on this, is that so, and the reason CDI decided to not do their own letter like DMHC, you know, under their letterhead was simply that, this might be the wrong word to use, a philosophical point that you'd rather have the insurance companies do it because they're the ones dealing directly with these people, and that seemed makes sense? Is that basically what it came down to? Because I guess in a way I would prefer if we were doing this together, we would send that out so we could have the data and we could sort of see what was happening. But I'm just kind of curious, is that what it was, more of a philosophical choice?
It really was. Okay. And again, it doesn't seem to have made a difference in the response rates, which method was done.
Right.
Probably in the future, I think we might want to go with the other, with sending it out under our own
name.
Well,
you can imagine the hearing we'd be having today in terms of if DMHC hadn't done that. Because then we would have no data.
Mm-hmm.
You know, or at least we wouldn't. The state wouldn't have a management if they didn't send out the letter as well. So it's good that at least somebody had a response directly from California, so we can track and say, well, we know the mail houses, you know, who did what. I mean, I know you're saying the insurers did that.
And we can get that
process.
Information from the.
No, I mean, I trust you. I got it. And it sounds like the data is right. I'm just glad that somebody did it, because if both didn't do it, then this would be a whole different hearing. We'd have to have, you know, other people come up here who aren't accountable to us and vice versa, telling us what they did or didn't do.
Yeah, and we are ultimately responsible.
Yeah.
I mean, we do take that
responsibility. Yeah, I would imagine your next choice would be that you would probably send out your own letter, right?
Can you say your name for the record?
Amy Daugherty.
Okay. You've answered a couple of questions and you didn't identify yourself. And
excuse me.
We're just dotting I's and crossing T's here. Assemblymember Emerson.
So there is a dispute on when the letters were sent out between what the committee found and what you testified to today. It seems that DHMC sent out a letter within a month after the settlement was done. Is that not correct?
They all went out by September and October of the same year that they were settled. Our last settlement occurred in July. Uh-huh. And
so it's within a couple of months.
That's right.
And the Department of Insurance, how soon were your letters sent out after?
It depended on the insurer we were negotiating with. I can get the specifics for you, but some of the cases were in litigation at the time, and we had to resolve legal matters before we could send out the letters.
So we
had no desire to drag this out at all.
Right. So you can get us that information on the timing of when the letters were sent out and give
yes.
it to the committee. Okay. And then my next question is, what were the fines spent on that you collected? Where did that money go?
Well, for our part, we would refer that question back to you because we send all of our fines to the general fund.
Well, we can't find them.
Yeah, that's what we're looking for. And
at that time, we had a managed care fund, and the fines come back to the managed care fund by statute.
Uh-huh. And in the statute, where what do you use those dollars for?
Those funds are used to run the department.
And Mr. Emerson, there was subsequent legislation that now requires our penalties to go to fund the programs administered by Mr. Mipp, as well as the Stephen Thompson Fund for physicians who've recently graduated practicing in rural areas.
So it didn't go back into any health care program?
No.
That's unfortunate. Thank you.
Just a follow-up question on this letter issue. Did either one of you pay someone to find people?
We didn't
to
have
find
to.
People. You did the legal search firm, but did either one of you pay to have these people found?
We don't have the authority to pay people to do that. We did utilize the agency who has expertise in finding those people, and the health plans paid that agency.
And the same for us. The insurers did pay for that second round of searching for people, but that was it was just one additional round.
Did you both use the same search firm?
We used Garden City Group.
I do not know.
Can you let us know who you used as well?
Sure.
And you didn't pay for it. The insurers did.
Correct.
You didn't pay for it. The insurers did.
Correct.
Okay. Assemblymember Buchanan.
I just have a quick question. So when we have the report that says 70% or whatever is confirmed receipt, how do you confirm the receipt of the letter? I mean, is it assuming that the letter just doesn't come back so they got it, or how are you confirming receipt?
Using Federal Express, there will be a signature to receive the packet, and the packet will come back to the mailer if it is not received. So we've got both a signature on those who received it, and we've got the return envelope for those who did not.
Okay. So, and similar for us, the package has to be signed for, and we've got the signatures on file for the ones who got it.
Okay.
Okay. Next set of questions on the. So we talked about the fines. Regulations. CDI is working on some regs that will be done here in the next couple of months.
May 10th.
The information we have is that DMHC has abandoned its regulatory process, although initially you had announced that you were going to issue joint regs. So, A, what happened to the joint regs? And B, a status report. So start with CDI.
We always prefer to work jointly on things like that, and that was our initial intention. The DMHC has an additional level of administrative accountability up the chain that we don't have as an independently elected official, so something like that. So they let us know that they were not going to be moving forward on them, but that's You know, the fact that one agency does have the regulations will, in fact, move enough of the market anyway, because most of the insurers do have folks on both sides.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, we haven't abandoned the regulations, but they are on hold currently because we found it unnecessary to draft regulations because of the five landmark corrective action plan settlement agreements that we entered into. We not only have established standards that regulations would serve, but we've actually implemented them. So we found it unnecessary at this time to draft additional regulations for something that we've already accomplished through our enforcement efforts.
Why did you not continue with the joint rulemaking with CDI?
Because as we went along, we found it unnecessary given the standards that we were developing. And if you were to take a look at the Department of Insurance regulations and compare them to our corrective action plans and our settlement agreements, you will find that they're very similar. They achieve all three goals. You know, they achieve this comprehensive underwriting process, the clear and unambiguous forms, and all the rest of the requirements that CDI has in its regulations are encompassed as part of our settlement agreements, and those are binding on the plans just as regulations would be binding on plans.
These are the corrective action plans that as of Monday you didn't have, yet by yesterday you had found and said we're done. These are corrective action plans that are not available on your website. So I want some clarity on these corrective action plans that are in lieu of non-existent regulations that you say aren't needed because you have the corrective action plans.
It's regrettable that there's been confusion.
Your name?
I'm sorry. My name's Marcy Gallagher, and I'm with the DMHC. It's regrettable that there's been confusion about those corrective action plans. All five plans submitted corrective action plans timely subsequent to the agreement, and they've all five have been approved. The corrective action plans included the licensing documents of the enrollment application, the disclosures in the EOC. And so we brought it along in terms of the initial submission, due diligence in reviewing and revising and dialoguing with the plan to ensure that the corrective action plan was implemented in their the issues identified in Exhibit B were incorporated into the corrective action plans, and all five have been approved. Implementation then was required within 120 days of approval. So we are now into implementation.
So 120 days of approval, you said that that was done back in 08?
The review process between the initial submission of a corrective action plan and the ultimate approval took a matter of months. And so in spring of 2009, corrective action plans were approved. Within 120 days, then they were to be implemented.
So by the fall of 2009?
The enrollment documents and the applications took a few additional months, and I think maybe that's where the confusion was. But at this time, all enrollment documents, applications, disclosures, and the corrective action plans to make changes in enrollment, underwriting, and investigation procedures are approved, and they are in implementation mode.
All five of them?
All five.
And so why aren't they available to the public? Why aren't they on your website? How could there possibly be confusion? What you're saying is pretty clear that it's been done. We've been preparing for this hearing for, I don't know, 5-6 weeks. And the first time we hear about all of this is yesterday.
The typical process when we audit plans is a process of auditing, finding our results, reporting the results to the plan, and having them offer corrective action plans to remedy whatever deficiencies that we find. Typically, those are confidential, or the plans request confidential treatment. We haven't gone the effort of actually posting corrective action plans on any survey, on any audit, any time. It wasn't on our radar to do that.
This is specific to DMHC.
There was this is from the, yes, go ahead.
Just a clarification. We don't need regulations because we have a corrective action plan, but nobody can see it? Because it's confidential?
Let me provide you a picture of why we don't need why we don't need regulations, and that is the chart that's behind you and the chart that's in front of you. Just by talking to the plans in 2006 and asking them about what their policies and procedures showed, they dropped doing their illegal rescissions to zero. The rescissions in total dropped 86% in 1 year, down to 1% currently of what they used to do.
Well, I can appreciate that, but he did ask a question.
The settlement agreements are public documents. Contained in the settlement agreements is the Exhibit B, which are the issues that are to be addressed in all of the corrective actions. Once the department has done due diligence to approve those corrective actions, it is very realistic for the public to assume the plans are doing everything that was required in the settlement.
It's realistic to assume the insurance companies that committed this illegal rescission have now found religion and
corrective actions are in implementation, and the regulatory agency responsible for that oversight is verifying all along the way that those things are being done.
How do we know?
Mr. Chair, Mr. Rambeau, yes. This is Tim LaBosse again. We have a handout that we provided to the committee members that summarizes essentially the actions, just a few examples actually from our corrective action plans. If you would like our department to report back to you with a more complete description of what these corrective action plans are, we certainly can. This is, you can tell from the reform actions that we've done, separate health questionnaires, application forms with questions that are clear, disclosures of underwriting rights, initiating and concluding investigations in a timely manner, and so forth. We'd be happy to.
Thank you. And I guess the confusion probably stems from this very simple fact. We have four of your draft correction action plans right here. We have one for Kaiser, HealthNet, we have one for PacifiCare, and one for Blue Shield. We got these from you. So we have four of them right here. They're drafts. They're all marked draft. So I imagine that the final is not too far away from these. This is why when you're telling us that they're final and they're confidential, it just doesn't make any sense. That's why I was so surprised yesterday when my staff told me that you said that these were all final. And then now I'm surprised that you're telling me that they're confidential and that they're not available. Well, I've got four drafts here.
We handle these corrective action plans not only for this particular investigation but for others in a confidential manner. We're willing to go back and revisit the publication of these particular corrective action plans if that is the recommendation of this committee. The reason or the fact that these corrective action plans are marked as draft is not as unusual as you're portraying. When a plan submits information to the department with the expectation that we will review, we will comment, and we will give the direction, it's not unreasonable for them to mark that as a draft as an indication to us that they will receive our feedback and finalize those documents.
But again, the fact that we have them shows that they're not this great big secret that you're portraying it to us.
Please don't misunderstand. I'm not portraying them as a secret. It has just been ongoing, the process of the department not to post corrective action plans.
Okay. Related, yes, Assembly Member of Alliance.
I just want to add a question on that point, and I'm sure there's a good reason for it. I'm not being argumentative. Why is there, maybe there's confidential data? Why aren't the corrective actions, if not public, on a website, at least, available to review or legislature? Because that's part of the whole line of questioning here is, why not? It seems to be like we're hiding something. I would think the more we put out there, the better, outside of personal information and things like that. So what was the decision or what's the thought behind or what's the practice and custom of keeping those confidential?
In terms of typically the survey is under the Section 1380 of the statute. There is nothing in law that requires the department to disclose the corrective action plan proposal. What we're required to do in a final report is to describe to the public the plan's efforts to correct those deficiencies.
Mm-hmm.
So when we look at sort of the granular documents submitted by the plan,
have dialogue back and forth with the plan on what we'll accept, what needs to be built up a bit.
Yeah.
The final approval of that corrective action plan then
Can you talk into the mic, please?
I'm just trying to. You don't have to
pull it towards you and bend it around or something. I know he's behind you, so I appreciate that.
Just look at Audra and Bill, you're fine.
The reference of those corrective action plans and the demonstration to the public is then by statute contained into the final survey report that is a public document.
So instead of having, you know, a bill or a piece of a bill get passed that mandates you guys to do it, why not just do an internal policy, communicate with the chairs and vice chairs of relevant committees and say that we're going to submit each time these are done to you for you and your staff to review or something like that? It'd be better than us putting together a bill, because that's what's going to happen if you don't, and it's going to get passed with the 20 other things in there, too.
There really is nothing in law that precludes us, but there's nothing in law that requires us.
Right.
Assemblymember Strickland, Vice Chair Strickland, I'm sorry.
I just wanted to clarify, I had made a statement earlier about the number of rescissions that had occurred since the settlement agreements in July of 2008. And can you confirm the number of rescissions that have occurred in DMHC during that time?
Yes, under DMHC's regulation, 9 have occurred since our settlement agreements were finalized in July of 2008. Four were in 2009, and 5 were in 2008 following our settlement agreements.
And how did you come to that number?
We asked the plans for that information, and our follow-up surveys have been monitoring all of the implementation of their new policies and procedures that our settlement agreements demanded.
Okay. Did the department set any goals during your negotiations of the settlement agreements? Did the department set any goals for re-enrollment of those who had their policies rescinded, or goals for reaching a number of people to be compensated by the plan as a part of the agreement?
We did not know what numbers would show. We certainly wanted a large participation. We also wanted it to be commensurate with other class actions, and with regard to the total of responses we received, we ended up at about 12% when class actions return about between 10 and 15%.
So your goal for those to be either compensated or re-enrolled was based on generally what class actions resulted?
It was the only thing we had to refer to.
Could you have yourself set goals for re-enrollment or financial compensation for the number of individuals who'd had their policies rescinded?
We could have. We did not know how many variables were there that had already been discussed in this committee about why they would not partake or take guaranteed issue coverage that would be offered to them.
Okay. What markers were set to determine that the plans were indeed doing as the settlement agreement stipulated?
The corrective action plans, again, the submission of those, the dialogue back and forth with the plans, conference calls, presentations of proposed changes to the underwriting procedures and the investigations. With respect to the enrollment documents, a team of survey and licensing counsel have been in constant dialogue with the plan over several months to ensure that these enrollment documents, a packet of 3 for all 5 plans, have adhered to the standards that we have set.
So looking prospectively, as if you could anticipate other issues arising that you deal with, Ms. Daubertine, would you anticipate the department looking to set sort of minimum goals, or at least identify different objectives for, I mean, obviously you wanted to contact everyone, but even within contacting everyone, you know, this many people we want to try to re-enroll, or at least get a piece of paper from them says that we're not interested, or that we found other coverage or whatever, because there doesn't seem to be much in the way of data, as we've pointed out. And obviously they could have found coverage through a government program. They could have found coverage with another company. They could have moved out of the state. I mean, all hosts of reasons why they didn't re-enroll or perhaps seek financial compensation. But have you, in hindsight, looked to reconsider how you might be able to do that and get more information as to why folks would participate or not participate?
We always accept all of the information we gain on a daily basis in our regulation of the health plans, and we will absolutely, you know, use all of the information that we have gained going through this very arduous process to, you know, set goals in the future and to educate our settlement processes in the future.
Thank you.
Assemblymember Emerson.
After 2005 and the decisions to reinstate individuals was there a big change in the fees that the individuals had to pay for the policies, or did they reinstate them at the existing fees?
What we required was that they had to reinstate them at market rates, not at anything that was uprated or increased due to any illness or pre-existing condition. So we made sure that they provided the very market rate that they would have had they stayed in the policy.
All right, thank you.
Assemblymember Buchanan.
I just have one question because, you know, 2020 hindsight's always perfect. And clearly we had abuses with rescission, and, you know, the choice was to deal with it in a certain way, either give the consumers the option to have their insurance reinstated and their bills paid, or to pursue legal action. And there were different approaches that were taken in terms of getting the letters out, whether you sent them out yourself and how quickly you got out, or you sent the letters out through the insurance companies. So my question is, what have we learned from this? I mean, what would you do different? What do we do moving forward? Clearly, if the rescissions are actually down to 9, then, you know, whether it was a perfect process or not, we've made tremendous progress. But going through all this, you know, in terms of lessons learned, can you just elaborate on what are the biggest lessons you've learned, what you think went well, and what you would do differently?
Well, I would have to say that I would not settle a matter as the LA City Attorney did and provide a lump sum to every single enrollee, no matter what the factual circumstances were of that case. When you reward the fraudulent consumers who obtained coverage through less than truthful means, you increase premiums for the entire population. As a regulator, we are protecting consumers on an industry-wide basis. So we found it important to hit the balance that we struck between weighing the need for stronger consumer protection against the ability to maintain access to that health coverage in the same state.
I think some of the lessons, as being chief of the survey division, you never know when you're getting the rainmaker. You never know when you have hit a huge issue that had the ramifications that post-claims underwriting had. We're bound to develop sufficient information, a basis of good cause, before we go and investigate a health plan. And so in that collection of information, whether it from the consumer complaints or the media or the private litigants, when we went out there, we had no idea what we would find. We wanted to go out fast. We wanted to find out as much information as we could. And quite frankly, in those early days, there was a level of, oh my God, kind of realization in that process. Rolling the surveys out to 5 health plans that comprise the entire industry of individual market, doing that timely, again, because when we found those egregious issues, the next logical step is that they need to be corrected. They need to be corrected immediately. We needed to impose the same and common changes to all 5 health plans, regardless of their business models and distinctions. That was a difficult thing to do. We're not in the business of directing how businesses are run, but we do require businesses comply with the law. And how do you do that for 5? And so it really stretched the resources to immobilize the expertise, the legal team, to enter relationships and dialogue with those five health plans, and to simply take on that enormous project at those early days and move it forward to where we are today. And to answer your question, I don't know how to do that any better than what we did. The lesson learned is be open to it. It will happen. Mobilize as many talented people as you can. Be sure you keep those relationships and pathways with the health plans, because that is where you are going to share this information and you are going to partner to improve the industry together. I think when you start separating that out, the regulator against the health plan, you lose a lot of leverage and ability to get responsive change from those health plans.
I think we achieved our goal as well. You know, the goal was to try to reform the healthcare market and ensure future compliance as a primary goal. And I think the chart that has been provided to the committee shows that we've done that. There are a few differences that weren't pointed out by the former individual who testified earlier today between our case and the LA City Attorney case. The LA City Attorney case, I think, has settled with one plan. They brought in actions against three. We brought it against the entire plan universe that provides 100% of the individual coverage in the market. And we think that we achieved very timely enforcement, and we're able to achieve what we're able to achieve, which was compliance, which is important.
So I think on our long-term goal of changing the marketplace, we were as successful as we had hoped. On the individual goal, I think the issues that have been raised in the committee here are important about knowing why it is that people make the decisions that they make. That can only be done, I guess, on a retrospective, maybe survey thing. That is something that we had not thought about in this case, and that may in fact be helpful information to guide us in future actions.
But do all of you feel that the 90 days response period was sufficient? Would you extend that at all to? If you were to have a future settlement, would you make that give a longer window to individuals?
So, well, with respect to the ability to file lawsuits, that was not a limited one. That's entirely
right,
up to them.
Just
for the offer of coverage, it does need to have some sort of a time limit on it. But in retrospect, maybe the 90 days could have been extended.
Oh, we thought that 90 days was appropriate for the same reasons, that there does need to be some time limit. We actually we got so much cooperation out of the health plans that they actually relaxed that for some extenuating circumstances, so it worked out just right.
Thank you. I'm going to follow up with a couple of questions. It seems to me the chart, I appreciate the simplicity of it, but when you look at the detail of it, Kaiser, as of 2006, is off the chart. So I would probably attribute that to Kaiser changing its policies, not to this wonderful settlement. And the other is Health Net, which after 2007 is off the chart. Kaiser's orange. Mm-hmm. After 2006, there's nothing. For
because
orange. I'm just going by your chart.
Because they stopped rescinding in November of 2006 when we finished our survey.
Yes, but they changed their policy.
They
the
stopped.
The people who continue to do it are the Blue Cross and Blue Shield, essentially, is who is left on the chart. So, and with regard to Health Net, they also stopped. And so whether that's because of your cap or because of what happened in L.A., we will never know. So getting back to the process of changing things going forward, applications, have you gone to one application, a unified application, CDI?
We're prohibited by law currently from doing that. So, but we are in fact working with each one of the insurers. We with a mind toward what our regulations are going to provide, that their applications will in fact be more appropriate and compliant by the time the regulations go into place.
DMHC.
There is no legal basis or requirement for plans to conform to one application.
Well, in fact, it's prohibited right now. But what have you done?
But in order to ensure that the applications fit into a comprehensive enrollment package to ensure that the medical underwriting was complete, that reasonable questions were resolved by the plan. The applications were subjected to a team of attorneys that used a common checklist that included both the unambiguous requirements on each question, on disclosure and warning statements to the consumer, on the consequences for not truthfully disclosing information, and also in ensuring that the EOC and the disclosure information were consistent with the application, so that these were done in package form to understand that the warnings, the clarity, simplification of those questions were uniform across the five plans.
Thank you. I think Mr. Labasse, you said that you did not want to go for a small one-time payment in your testimony. You just referenced how horrible it was that the LA City Attorney did it the way they did it, because cashing people out was not the answer. The Daily Journal reported that Blue Cross inserted a third option to its former enrollees above and beyond what you negotiated, that they would accept $1,000 no questions asked in exchange for dropping all claims against the company. How did that get into the letter to Blue Cross, or from Blue Cross or how did the Blue Cross offer that? If it wasn't part of your settlement, how do they offer $1,000 no questions asked to these victims? And what did you do about it?
They asked to offer that. It was part of the direct negotiations of option one of our settlement agreement, and many enrollees wanted that option, so we weren't about to take away an option that many enrollees wanted.
So the testimony that we had today of Mr. Labasse, that you didn't want to go for a small one-time payment, and your testimony that the state, that the approach that was taken by the LA City Attorney to get all of these victims in LA their settlement dollars, that was the wrong way to go. You were willing to go for $1,000 one-time settlement. That's okay. That's okay with the Department of Managed Health Care.
I don't understand the comparison. It's apples and oranges.
It's multi-million dollar settlement for a few hundred folks in LA. It's the testimony here that you did not want to go for a small one-time settlement, and then allowing Blue Cross to cash out for $1,000.
The small one-time settlement that he referred to did not contain anything about reinstatement for coverage. That was the first offer that the plaintiff's bar made to Blue Cross, to say we will settle it for $1,000 for every enrollee, never mind how many damages each enrollee had, up to $175,000, which were paid out under our settlement agreements for one enrollee. So that settlement that he is referenced in his testimony did not contain any reinstatement of coverage going forward, which was historical for the DMHC to take on to provide coverage on a guaranteed issue basis in a state that has no guaranteed issue.
Okay.
And therefore must suffer with rescissions.
Then we get back to performance then. The performance is clear. Less than 5% at the Department of Managed Health Care and less than 5% at the Department of Insurance got their insurance back.
And that is, you know, that gets, so if you didn't get the penalties, you didn't get the money, and the folks didn't get their insurance back, what did we get at the end of the day?
Actually, the director, or rather Director Enos, found it reprehensible that those who stood to gain monetarily from the failure of our settlement agreements would publicly criticize them and confuse the enrollees and scare them from taking guaranteed issue on a going forward basis or expedited reimbursements. By the way, every single one of our enrollees who wanted reimbursement received that reimbursement within months. Other enrollees in the blue class actions have been waiting for 5 years and are nowhere near getting reimbursed for their damages.
We're talking about the $800,000 or so that has been reimbursed.
No, we're not. We're talking about the Blue Cross class action. We're talking about the Blue Shield class action.
I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about the DMHC. There's been about $800,000 that's been recouped.
There's been over $870,000 reimbursed to enrollees.
Right, which is for 92 enrollees, which is over $9,000 per enrollee. I think if you compare that to the 1,000 enrollees in the LA City Attorney case, it's more on average than that. But going back to the comment on the chart and Kaiser dropping off that chart and so forth, that's the most important accomplishment that the department had, is that it reformed the marketplace. People did change their policies and practices because of our action, and we're proud of that.
Kaiser and PacifiCare were not sued by the LA City Attorney. That drop off by Kaiser is not due to any action by the LA City Attorney. It was due to the DMHC alone.
Well, we can quibble over motivations. If there's no other questions, Assemblymember Valines.
I do. I don't want it to be lengthy, but it might be a little bit, so I apologize if I drag it on. I'm actually just really curious in the spirit of, first of all, I'm glad to hear that everyone's doing everything they can to make sure that people are getting what they're supposed to get. The problem we're trying to address is what people didn't get it, and you've answered that to a certain degree. So I have three general questions, and it's appropriate for both to respond however you want. On this process, what's your general reflection? What things could be done better? You know, what things are working? And then the last part of that would be, what can we do to help? So is there anything we can do to help make this process easier, or is there something we're trying to do that's going to make it worse? And I'll end with this, because there's been a couple comments back to your opening,
right,
and to the comments just made. If we had guarantee issue, if we had, you know, mandated coverage, that might make things different. I'm really curious. Is that what you're maybe suggesting as solutions? I mean, I'm trying to find out, how do we solve the problem, and what are your thoughts, and how do we not make it worse?
Well, I think you're asking a question of policy. What could we do going forward as a policy basis? And while I'd like to answer that question, I think that matters of policy through the administration have to go through the appropriate channels. So we can have conversations about that outside the committee room and so forth, but I think that if you're asking what more you can do as a legislative body in enacting legislation, I don't think that we can answer that question at this time, because we would need authority to answer that question. I cannot think of anything other than that chart that I'm looking at right now and saying that we were as successful as possible. We were a leader in the nation, that our standards that we set changed the marketplace. And they were a model that were built upon by everyone, including the LA City Attorney. So I would have to say, in retrospect, we wouldn't have done anything differently.
So as I mentioned earlier, we certainly think that we have been successful in changing the marketplace and changing the behavior of the insurers. We haven't solved the underlying problem of underwriting in the individual market. This legislature has discovered how difficult that can be. Congress is discovering how difficult that is right now. As long as we have this problem, we as the regulator have to deal with it. Solving that problem is an intractable political problem.
Yeah, Ms. Daubertine, the class action cases against Blue Shield and Blue Cross have not been totally settled. Is that not correct?
They are stayed in litigation pursuant to appeals taking place.
So the the agreement that you got, we settled those cases and people got back on health care plans much quicker than through the class action. So is that not correct?
That's correct, within months.
Less than 5%. Let's be clear.
Everyone who wanted it.
Okay. That being an important point. Now, let me ask you this question. The chair says the fines were not collected. What fines were not collected by your department?
That's not true at all for the DMHC. Every single fine levied was collected within 15 days of the signature on the page.
No, and that was
13.65 million.
And roughly six from CDI. Is that not correct?
I think it's closer to five.
Five. Okay. So the fines that were levied have all been collected. Is that correct?
So I believe ours had been collected, but it sounds like if you guys have collected all of yours and the chair thinks that some haven't been, that leaves us. I will look into that.
Okay. If you could get back to us on that, appreciate it. Sure. Thank you.
My last question before we open it up to the public. Third-party review. Independent third-party review. There's a discrepancy, a difference in how you handle that. CDI requires it. DMHC does not. So can you speak to that, starting with CDI?
So, well, it, you know, I mean, the policy of it is, I think, self-evident. The insurers, as the adjudicator of who may have lied or who may have withheld information, obviously have a self-interest. While the law doesn't permit us right now to do third-party review, the fact is that we were able to get that in settlement. It occurred to the insurers that was a good idea. And it certainly occurred to us.
In the corrective action plans pursuant to the settlement, the plans are required to have a staff separate from those that did the initial underwriting evaluate any proposed rescissions. The Blue Cross is elected to have 30-part review, which is a voluntary action and decision, business decision on their part. HealthNet as well is using third-party review. Blue Shield is electing to do a third-party review on any appeal that may come from a rescinded policy.
But not on the initial.
They do a separate committee comprised of a medical physician, attorney, and separate staff from the underwriting staff to evaluate the proposed rescission, go back through and ensure that the medical underwriting was completed. And if it was not completed, they will not rescind unless there's evidence of willful misrepresentation.
I like that standard. So some are doing employees of the insurance company to make these decisions on rescission in terms of the review.
The Blue Shield uses a separate committee, internal, and the third party is on the appeal.
Thank you very much. I appreciate walking us through the different steps, the key steps of the settlement process and what we have as of this day. I think that 6,000 people, your charges as the regulators in both markets, depend on you, and I can appreciate Ms. Daubertine's snappy answers, but the bottom line is this: your responsibility is to those 6,000 initially, because that's what the settlements were about, and to the general public going forward, and that's what we're concerned about here. Skipping over to this fancy chart, which, by the way, I noticed CDI did not bring their fancy chart. Have you had an 86% drop?
So we have to do ours by a data call. So we've got the information coming in right now from 2009.
Okay.
And as soon as that's available, we will provide it to you.
Thank you very much.
We expect it to be similar to that.
Okay. So it's a two-part process, and I think what we have seen here is a lack of information to be able to make a judgment as to what has happened in the last couple of years with regard to follow through on these settlements. With that, anybody in the public, in the audience, wishing to come forward and speak? Seeing no one, we have 2, 4, 5, 8. We're still short. All right, we'll start the discussion on the potential recommendations that are listed here on tab 6. The first is to require DMHC and CDI to submit reports to the committee describing the results of each department's agreements. The report should include the number of consumers who accepted new insurance, the number of consumers who sought reimbursements. The report should summarize the corrective action plans. Summarize, not all in specificity, although it would be very good if we had it public. And the differences among the corrective action plans, and describe the department's strategies for ensuring the full implementation of each action plan. Although I think those only apply to Department of Managed Healthcare. I don't know that the CDI had caps. Request that the Department of Managed Healthcare, like the Department of Insurance, require an independent third-party review process as part of the correction action plans for each of the five health plans. Request that most of them are doing it anyways, I think it's not a big leap to not have employees of the insurance company involved in these decisions. Request that the Department of Managed Healthcare restart the rulemaking process it began to implement rescission. You have five corrected action plans. I would think it would be quite simple to merge them into one regulatory process. Request that the Assembly Budget Subcommittee number 1 on Health and Human Services zero out the budget for DMHC until the department agrees to complete its rulemaking process on rescission regulations. That would be something that would be referred to sub 1, which I sit on, and I think there might be another member of this committee that sits on it. And then an additional one that isn't listed here, I think, is to track everybody down, track the 6,000 folks down. That is something I think that and I didn't ask this earlier, but the simplest thing in the world would be to go to BOE and FTB, because you have applications for each one of these consumers. You have their names. You have their Social Security number, because you have to put that on the application. You give that to FTB and BOE, and I can assure you, you will get much better results on finding out where these folks are. And clearly, not every effort. Sending a FedEx package and then having some firm that does class action suits do the follow-up is just clearly wasn't enough in this case, because we don't have the data. So those are the recommendations. It's open for discussion.
On item 1, I would move approval.
Okay.
Second. Item 1.
Oh, wait. Do we have 10 yet? Hold on a second. 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. We're going to have to do roll call first. Call the roll.
De La Torre.
Here.
Strickland. Arambula.
Here.
Berryhill. Block.
Here.
Buchanan. Caballero, Emerson, here. Fletcher, Fuentes, Hagman, here. Huber, Jeffries,
here.
Jones, Lowenthal,
here.
Perez,
here.
Valines,
here. Okay. So we have a motion on the first one, the first bullet point. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Call the roll.
De La Torre.
Aye.
Strickland. Arambula.
Aye.
Berryhill. Block.
Aye.
Buchanan.
Aye.
Caballero. Emerson.
Aye.
Fletcher. Fuentes. Hagman.
Aye.
Huber. Jeffries.
Aye.
Jones. Lowenthal.
Aye.
Perez.
Aye.
Valines.
Aye. Any other motions on these items?
A question on item 2.
Yes.
Item 2, I guess, is supportable if we could identify how it's going to be funded.
Well, it's already, as it was said, they were, I think it was three of the five have already agreed to do independent third-party review internally. So, yeah, the insurers have agreed. Three of the five, I think, was the number, have agreed to do independent third-party review. So it's really just a question of the other two that are not doing it.
And the funding to pay for the third party is done
as part of their settlement.
As part of their settlement.
The recommendation implies that the Department of Managed Care is going to do it and pay for it. So I think that's the question.
Like they did in those three of the five have done it themselves. So what we're saying is the other two should do it as well.
We change the motion so that they have to so that we require the companies to do them and report back to us. I mean,
The Department of Managed Healthcare is the regulatory body. So if you want to, I think we all understand what we're saying here. That the phrasing here is require an independent third party review. So.
Basically, though, this is just a recommendation for them.
Well, we're gonna engage with the department going forward.
Okay, and so through. To clarify, is that this committee then is recommending that each of the health plans who entered into the settlement agreements do and pay for a third party?
And again, three of the five are already.
I understand
doing
that.
It.
I'm looking for clarification of the motion.
Yes, that okay. The two that are outstanding that are not doing independent third party review, do it.
Yes. Report back to us. So can we change the motion to reflect that?
I think that's all of our understanding, and I would agree that that's if that's the understanding, then if you want to put that in the form of a motion, we'll do that version of it.
Require all five insurance companies who are part of the settlement to complete a third-party review process. Three of them already have.
DHC.
Okay, he wrote it down. So that's the motion.
Second.
And we have a second. Roll call.
De La Torre.
Aye.
Strickland. Arambula.
Aye.
Berryhill. Block.
Aye.
Buchanan.
Aye.
Caballero. Emerson. Fletcher, Fuentes, Hagman, Huber, Jeffries, Jones, Lowenthal, Perez, Valines.
Okay.
Strickland, aye.
The third, or are there any others of these? The tracking everyone down.
Jeffries, aye.
Through FBOE or FTB, or restarting the rulemaking process, and then the adjunct to that is the budget.
Emerson, aye.
I made the motion, so I'm up to.
Okay.
I'd like the track and follow through the 6,000. I think we need that data.
Through the BOE and FTB.
Or whatever,
okay.
Just to make a good effort to go. I don't know which resources.
There's okay.
A lot cheaper ways of doing that, but.
You may not ever be able to find out.
Yeah. 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 I'm not saying they're proper.
I don't know the answer now. Maybe that's for the next
one. Oh, that would be a possibility for them to pursue. I think that would be the easiest.
To try a couple years later to go back and retrack all 6,000 claimants would be.
I'm sorry, can I seek a clarification? The third-party review process, is that for prospective rescissions or for the rescissions that occurred under the settlement agreement?
It's prospective. It's an amalgamation, essentially, of their corrective action plans that they've already entered into. Some blending of those would be the regs because they've already entered into them.
Thank you.
It was the testimony we heard today. So we'll start with the tracking everyone down. There seems to be consensus there.
No?
Or,
I'm not clear. Is this a new one? It's
I added it on because it seemed to be a concern of the committee was we don't have the data. So how do we get the data? And Assemblymember Hagman.
Well, as a private investigator, I can tell you how I can find it, but I don't know what the right government way of doing it, okay? But I think, you know, having data from 3 or 4 years ago from a letter saying they haven't got it isn't enough at this point. I think if we could ask the departments to reengage and see if they can make good faith efforts to try to track down and what happened, what was the follow through? Did they get other insurance policies? Did they have other things? I think that was one of the early contention points that to make any conclusions about having that data.
Mr. Chair, I would just suggest, or where I'm comfortable, is I don't want to do something on the. Sorry. You don't have to do that. Just yell at me. I don't want to do a motion like this. No, yeah. I just don't want to do it on the fly. I think we all agree that
so we can bring that back in 2 weeks.
Let's bring it back in and work it through because I'd like to know, but I sure don't want to start putting money into a rabbit hole that we can't figure something out.
We'll put together a recommendation fleshed out. We'll vote on it in 2 weeks. Anything regarding the rulemaking?
Yes, Mr. Chair.
Yes, Assemblymember Arambula.
As I heard the discussion, it sounded like there was an argument that we don't need rulemaking because we fixed the problem. And yet, you know, the implementation of the statutory language depends on the people there, and that may be in good hands this year, but that could change a year or two from now. And I think part of the reason we got into this discussion was how these instances of rescission were addressed, and because there weren't any rules, they kind of did it on an ad hoc basis. So I would move that we request that they restart the rulemaking process, because it's always good to have something in place should inappropriate behavior occur. Now, if these folks, you know, many of us are going to be gone either this year or in the next couple of years, and the staff may be gone in a couple of years. If we should see a resurgence of these rescissions and we don't have a rulemaking process, then my concern is that we will likely have a repeat of what's happened over the last couple of years, and that is that we deal with it on an ad hoc basis. I think we need to have some rules in place to deal with it, even though it may not be a problem now. Although, you know, I would like to see that information also. But for those reasons, I would move that we request the department to restart their rulemaking process.
Thank you. Wait, yes.
I guess I'm trying to be practical here, in that because no one can justify some of the rescissions that were taking place. I think all of us agree that. That was a practice that needed to be stopped and revised. And, you know, so now we've been told that they've changed the rules and regulations, and we've got rescissions down to, you know, nine rescissions. But
to be clear, they did not change the rules and regulations. Okay. They have entered into these
arrangements. All right. Well, okay, they've accomplished our goal. Okay. So what I'm trying to ascertain here is we're saying restart the process. Is there a reason we're not just having them finish the current process and we're having them restart and go back to 2007? I'm just a little confused here.
Well, but in the course of the discussion, we were talking about these corrective action plans, that there's five of them
right.
that apparently are final. And so then the rulemaking process would essentially be blending those five into one set of rules that would be a baseline going forward.
You're saying restart the process. I'm trying to understand.
Well, because they stopped it. They stopped their previous process. So whether it's restarting that one or starting from where they are right now with the CAPs, it doesn't really matter.
What we're trying to do is get them to come back to us with the guidelines?
Is with regulations, yes.
Although, doesn't it matter, Mr. Chairman, if, as our recommendation references, a 2007 memo from DMHC, is it related? And
we can remove that reference and
right,
just
I'm
go.
I'm concerned about the willful misrepresentation issue. So that's
they seem to have changed their minds on that over time too. But again, that's why these regulations are important, because there are changes in approaches. Assemblymember Valines.
Again, it sounds like we're being a little general, so I just because I support what Ms. Strickland is talking about, that
I would be uncomfortable going back to 07 because my understanding, now I haven't sat down and read them all, so I need to, but my understanding is going back to 07, you do have some terminology that's difficult for us.
Okay, well, we could end it at request of the Department of Managed Health Care.
Complete
the rulemaking process.
Okay, let me just finish my train of logic is that I'm very comfortable supporting that concept that says, you know, just basically take these reports you're doing and finalize what you have. And I think they should also take those and make sure that if they are somehow private for a reason because of data or personal issues, that they should definitely submit them to the chairs and the vice chairs of all relevant committees so we don't run into a problem again where it feels like they're hiding information. So that would be good. I just want to make sure we're not opening up.
So, you know. It would read now, request that the Department of Managed Health Care complete the rulemaking process with regard to rescissions. Okay. Yeah.
But we want it done, Mike.
I don't want it to be done in December next year. No, I want it.
Yes,
that is. Okay, well, I have a motion.
So he amended?
Yeah, yes. As amended. And a second. Okay, call the roll. Yeah.
De La Torre?
Aye.
Strickland? Arambula,
aye.
Berryhill, Block, Buchanan,
aye.
Caballero, Emerson, Fletcher, Fuentes, Hagman,
aye.
Huber, Jeffries,
aye.
Jones, Lowenthal,
aye.
Perez, the lines.
Thank you. And I'm going to save us all a lot of discomfort. I'll unilaterally remove the budget one. We'll repackage these. We'll have the discussion. And then in 2 weeks, we will vote on the tracking down recommendation. Thank you all very much. We're going to stay open for a few more minutes. I will stay here, but you all can go. Thank you.